Yep.
That's it.
Good morning. I'm Jane Harmon, the president and CEO of the Wilson Center. Welcome to all of you. I know it's hard to get into this building. We appreciate your patience. 100 years ago, in 1917, the United States was in the midst of a global war so ferocious and so fearsome that it was known at the time as the Great War. This country's 28th president, whose name happens to be Woodrow Wilson, had been reelected the year before after campaigning on a promise to keep the United States out of the conflict. We all know how the story ended. More than 100,000 Americans were killed in the war, which claimed some 17 million soldiers and civilians worldwide. Much of Europe was flattened. It was carnage and destruction on a scale that surpassed the worst nightmares at the time. Since then, historians have taken a closer look at the events leading up to the war and what ultimately caused it. Some of those historians, in fact, have been scholars here at the Wilson Center. More recently, the view has emerged that the United States and possibly the rest of the belligerents could have avoided war had it not been for a series of dire miscalculations. What remains beyond question, however, is the heroism and valor of those who fought. In the centuries since, the world has witnessed war on an even more staggering scale, including wars where the motives of political leaders were more explicitly questioned, not just after the fact, but during and throughout. One in particular also cast a shadow over the American soldiers who bravely fought. Their welcome home was ambivalent. Of course, I'm referring to the Vietnam War, the subject of Ken Burns' epic 18-part documentary, which we are here to preview and discuss. While we can look back at conflicts like World War I through the buffer of intervening years, Vietnam was my generation's war. It's personal to me and many in this room. I had friends who were drafted, friends who never came home, friends who were able to dodge the draft. Many fought honorably, including two who will speak today. The United States lost more than 58,000 service members. And on a wall in Venice, California, which was part of my old congressional district, is a name of those POWs and MIAs we still can't account for. Vietnam left a scar on this country, not just in our collective psyche or in a philosophical sense, but in real life terms. And the homeless on the beaches in California, Mike Mullen's old stomping ground too, from the Vietnam War, tell that tale. There's also an argument, these people are an example of history as present day reality in flesh and blood, and an example of how we have yet to come to terms fully with the war and its impacts. That's also an argument for why we need historians. I'm sure that Ken agrees that history is not only about the past and what really happened on the ground. It is also in large part about how much people know or admit or accept today as having happened. Indeed, the scars of history don't just heal on their own. In an interview with my hometown paper, the LA Times, last week, Ken Burns said he was humiliated by what he didn't know about the war. Well, the decade of work that he and his amazingly brilliant colleagues devoted to this project will now serve as an amazing, as an impressive education for us all. Similarly, the work of the Wilson Center's award-winning History and Public Policy Program, headed by Christian Osterman, whom I'm sure is in this room, provides exceptional educational value. Our digital archive, available for free on the web, includes an extensive collection of primary sources on the Vietnam War, including telegrams, minutes, and discussion notes from the mid-1950s to the end of the 1970s. Many of these materials were obtained by the Wilson Center from the hard-to-access archives of North Vietnam, and they include truly fascinating revelations. We're honored today to partner with the Better Angels Society to host this exclusive preview and discussion of the Vietnam War. Lynn Novick and Ken Burns are national treasures. I believe, actually, that Ken's only competition for leading public historian of our time is the musical Hamilton. He can't sing. That's what he just said. Our panel, I actually wrote that line. Our panel, and I can't sing either. Our panel, all friends, includes Admiral Mike Mullen, who served as chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, among other things, while I was in Congress. A veteran of the Vietnam War, he is also a member of the board of the Better Angels Society. Former U.S. Army General Barry McCaffrey, who received 3 Purple Hearts for injuries sustained during his service in Vietnam. Our moderator, Evan Thomas, is a journalist, historian, and the author of superb books, including a very thoughtful book on President Eisenhower, who warned against going into Vietnam. Evan is currently working on a book on Sandra Day O'Connor. Maybe that's a secret, but hey.
No longer.
aren't we all excited about that? And I want to acknowledge a number of our guests. I hope they're all here. Former U.S. Ambassador to Korea, Mark Lippert. Anthony Fox, former Secretary of Transportation. John Parrish Petey, Acting Chairman of the National Endowment for the Humanities. Nancy Cable, Board Chair of the Better Angels Society. 2 of our board members, Thelma Duggan and Earl Stafford, and numerous members of our Wilson Council. I saw Ambassador Stuart Bernstein, among others. A special shout out to Amy Berg, the President and Chief Philanthropic Officer of the Better Angels Society. She is a friend from her long experience at the Aspen Institute and a wonderful, wonderful person. She's also a resident of the Jacksonville area and says her house is okay. Sadly, so many were not. Another shout out goes to the more than 20 military academies watching today's event via our live stream, including the men and women of West Point and the Virginia Military Institute. We honor your extraordinary service. Finally, thanks to the Bank of America for supporting Ken's work and this very special event. Please welcome Larry DeRita, Bank of America's Head of Global Marketing and Corporate Affairs.
Thank you, Jane. Thank you very much. And thank you to the Wilson Center for having this great event. It's a terrific honor to be associated with Ken Burns and Lynn Novick and their film production company. We've been partners with them for many years, and with this project in particular, we're very, very proud. On behalf of our CEO, Brian Moynihan, my boss, Vice Chairman Ann Finucane, who is the inspiration behind our partnership with Ken and Lynn, I just want to thank you all for coming today. You know, we've had a Bank of America, a really unique relationship with the military, and our partnership with Ken helps us highlight that. We probably have 5% of our workforce that are former military out of 200,000 people, and we hire about 2,000 military and former military families a year. So it's a great thing that we're very proud of. We operate, this is kind of a unique role that we play. Bank of America operates all the banking centers on military installations around the world. So if you walk into the Guam or Kwajalein Island or Diego Garcia and go to a banking center, it's a Bank of America employee in there, and it's a Bank of America banking center. It's something we've been doing for many, many years. We view it as one of the many unique relationships that we have with the military, and we're very proud of that. So again, we're very proud to be associated with Ken and Lynn. It's a terrific honor to be part of this event today with these distinguished Americans on the panel, and we thank you very much for coming today, and thank you. I'll turn it over.
Let's play the first clip.
For all of John Kennedy's soaring rhetoric, for all the talent he gathered around him, the first months of his presidency did not go well. He approved a CIA-sponsored invasion of Cuba at the Bay of Pigs that ended in disaster. He felt he'd been bullied by Soviet Premier Nikita Khrushchev at a summit meeting in Vienna. He was unable to keep the Soviets from building the Berlin Wall. And in Southeast Asia, he refused to intervene against a communist insurrection in Laos. Critics accused him of being immature, indecisive, inadequate to the task of combating what seemed to be a mounting communist threat. There are just so many concessions that we can make in 1 year and survive politically, he confided to an aide in the spring of 1961. In South Vietnam, Kennedy felt he had to act. After the president received reports that the Viet Cong might be in control of more than half the densely populated Mekong Delta, he dispatched General Maxwell Taylor and Walt Rostow to Vietnam. They urged him to commit American ground troops. Kennedy refused. It would be like taking a first drink, he said. The effect would soon wear off, and there would be demands for another and another and another. Instead, in the midst of a Cold War with its constant risk of nuclear confrontation, the president supported a new, flexible way to confront and contain communism. Limited war.
This is another type of warfare. New in its intensity, ancient in its origin, war by guerrillas, subversives, insurgents, assassins, war by ambush instead of by combat, by infiltration instead of aggression.
Point in 1964, so you were a junior officer when you got into all this. Did you think you were getting into a new war, new kind of war?
Well, by the way, by background, 1960, we marched in the inauguration for Kennedy. 3 feet of snow in the streets. We loved the guy. He was a hero to America. It's so painful watching that clip and thinking about not just a new kind of war, but how we got involved in Vietnam. I told Lynn I took a delegation to Vietnam a few years back. Vietnam veterans, Jan Scruggs is here, and it was an incredible visit. But part of it was a sort of a growing recognition. The elections we made in a series of events in the early 60s that got us involved against the advice of all sorts of people, including my dad, who was a colonel in the Pentagon at the time, and he and Andy Goodpaster and others who were Korean War veterans said, do not get involved in a war in the mainland of Asia. But I think at the time, and you know, in the 64 when we came out, the whole notion of a new kind of war was very attractive to us. I got committed to the 82nd Airborne to an intervention in the Dominican Republic. When we got back, we raced to Washington, a carload of infantry lieutenants to volunteer for Vietnam because they had just committed a Marine regiment and the 173rd Airborne Brigade, and we figured we had 6 months to get in the war before it was over. Oh, here a decade later, 2 million dead. And I think throughout the government, and Ken's and Lynn's film makes a good argument about this, these were good, smart people. Yeah. Making what, in retrospect, were disastrous decisions.
Lynn, you mentioned to me last night or the other night that one thing you discovered was these great decision makers had a lot of doubts about what they were doing. And we heard it with President Kennedy. It's like taking another drink. Talk to us a little bit about that as you got into that, what you found there.
For all of us working on the project, it's been a revelation to go back into the Pentagon Papers and the telephone conversations that we hear with Kennedy, Johnson, and Nixon to a lesser degree about the doubts, but the sense that privately they never could really figure out a way to see a future that guaranteed we would win the war. There was always tremendous doubt that it was possible, and yet there was also seemingly no questioning about whether, therefore, we should not be doing it. It was sort of a given that we're doing it, but yet we don't see a way to make it work. And again and again and again, it's a devastating series of conversations and revelations that, you know, it's hard to make sense of when you're next to brave Americans who went there and did their duty, not knowing that that's what our leaders were thinking at the time.
So, Admiral Mullen, you're in the Naval Academy in this period, 64 to 68. I think you were class of 68. Right. How aware were you as a young midshipman that there was this tension that yes, this is a war we have to be in, but our leaders are not so sure we should be in it. Were you even aware of that as a midshipman?
No, hardly at all. I call it the cocoon we were raised in at the time, you know, inside those walls. But I actually took a trip to visit a boyhood, childhood friend of mine in the spring of 67 who was in school up at Cornell. And he asked me to go to an event that night where Dean Rusk, who was the Secretary of State, was speaking. His son had invited his dad to come and speak. Small auditorium, standing out in front very early, and you could see the split, you know, standing on the steps. We go in, as I recall, it was about 2000, and there were two things that happened just before the president introduced to Secretary Rusk. They marched 13 women in full black mourning garb to sit in the 13 seats that were in front. And as Rusk got introduced and we sat down, half the audience reached under their chairs and pulled out skeleton masks. And I'm sitting in the middle of this going, holy cow, what is going on? And that was a real awakening for me. That Saturday was also the same night, I think, that McGeorge Bundy got kicked off the stage at Berkeley. So that was a wake-up call in my third year, but still back in the cocoon for the last year, not quite as much because we had the riots at Baltimore and Washington. I was dating my, you know, then-to-be wife. Couldn't even get in to see her here because the National Guard had D.C. blocked down because it was burning. So my education really started then.
Ken, this is, I think, your third big war. Are they all like this, or is this one different?
They're all like this, and this one is different, Evan. I think that the soldiers that we talked to on both sides, you know, we were all three sides. We had North Vietnamese soldiers and Viet Cong guerrilla, as well as a huge range of American military experience from the bottom up, less from officer and above. And you cannot help but remark on the similarity, and yet you also feel the uniqueness of this, the lack of support at home or the developing lack of support at home, the asymmetricality in a way that perhaps we had not experienced since the revolution in terms of us doing it to somebody else, in terms of the insurgency. And I think Lynn explained it very well, just a sense of not sort of knowing at any given time, as LBJ says, in an anguish tape, as the Marines are landing there at Da Nang in March of 65, I see no daylight. He sort of weeps, laments to Richard Russell, his friend. I can't see any daylight in Vietnam, and nobody could see any daylight. And I think what you've seen from that very short clip is the way in which the politicians get boxed into feeling like they have to make certain decisions that don't really make sense in the long run. And we could back this up, General, to 45, where the OSS is supporting Ho Chi Minh, arming the Viet Minh. He wants to change the name to the Viet American Army. He's quoting Jefferson when he declares Vietnamese independence. There's an OSS officer right by him. And a few weeks later, the phone call's coming in, you know, this guy's a bad guy, we're going with de Gaulle, we're going to reinstate the colonial thing. And you can go back to Wilson, where he isn't given a petition that a very young Ho Chi Minh is submitting to him at the Hotel Crillon in Paris when they're sussing out the whole end of World War I. It is missed opportunities. I've likened it to the sign saying, bridge out 3 miles, stop, bridge out 2 miles, and we just keep racing through, finally busting through the barricades, and then we find ourselves in midair. Like, oh yeah, what happened?
Let's show that next clip because it has LBJ's anguish in it.
In March of 1965, Johnson finally took the action he had managed to avoid for so long. Kiss me He was putting American ground troops in Vietnam. The government of South Vietnam was not even consulted. The United States of America had larger considerations.
Clearly, we saw it in terms of the Cold War. Assistant Secretary of Defense John McNaughton said, our interests there were 70% to avoid humiliation, 20% to contain China, and 10% to help the Vietnamese.
Johnson quietly told his good friend, Senator Richard Russell of Georgia, what was about to happen.
I guess we got no choice, but scares the death out of me. I think everybody's going to think we're landing the Marines, we're off to a battle, and of course, if they come up there, they're going to get them in a fight. And if they ruin those airplanes, everybody's going to give me hell for not securing them, just like they did last time they made a raid.
Yeah.
What do you think?
Well, brother, it scares the life out of me, but I don't know how to back up now. It looks to me like we just got in this thing and there's no way out.
I don't know. Dick, the great trouble I'm under. A man can fight if he can see daylight down the road somewhere.
Sure,
but there ain't no daylight in Vietnam. There's not a bit.
So you can feel the terrible political pressure that the president's under in a broad sense. I mean, 70% of the motivation, according to McNaughton, is credibility. But it does raise the question, and we have military men I'd like to ask this of, what is the duty of the military in this situation to warn the president what he's getting into, even if there are all these political ramifications? And how good a job did they do back in 1965, or so this is about where we are now, in sort of telling the president, hey, this is what you're getting into?
Well, H.R. McMaster's book certainly is a data point worth looking at. I think in general, they went in there and they tried to be frank to the president, the history of it says, and he basically overrode their objections. And to some extent, by the way, I think their objections, they probably weren't well-founded. It was put in terms of, are you willing to fight China in terms of a larger struggle? And by the way, you know, at the time, 1966.
So they warned him about the wrong thing.
Yeah, I think so. And I think LBJ didn't want to take advice from the military at that point. Their political considerations are larger. But, you know, in 66, I was a Vietnamese-speaking assistant battalion advisor to a South Vietnamese parachute infantry battalion. I was so thrilled I was there, I couldn't believe it. They were terrific soldiers. We loved the Vietnamese, the culture, we thought we were doing the right thing. So there was a widespread feeling, I think, in the armed forces on the ground that this was a good war. And I wrote a letter in the New York Times a few weeks back that said that was probably the last period, 66, when we thought we knew what we were doing, we thought we could win. And by the way, that was a year when the U.S. presence overwhelmed the Vietnamese. The Vietnamese took the largest casualties in this war, bar none. Their civilians suffered as much as the North Vietnamese civilians. So I think the bottom line to the whole thing was by 66, there was a sense of inevitability of being drawn into a larger struggle. And then later on, you know, I was very close to Westmoreland as a family friend of my dad. The world's best-looking general that ever lived. And I don't say that to be, you know, he was just the epitome of what we wanted to be as 18-year-old cadets. And, you know, if he'd been in World War II as a four-star general, he'd have a statue up at West Point in a plane right now. Mm-hmm. But I think, to be frank, he never got a clue as to what was happening in the war. One of the books that just came out claims, well, he was lying and, you know, falsifying data. I don't believe that. I think the military does have a tendency, by the way, if you throw us down a well and start pouring doo-doo on our head, 10 minutes later, we'll tell you that we're in the perfect place we've always wanted to be. I think to some extent that's what happens with senior military guys in a bad situation. But But, you know, again, back to the tragedy, the political part of it went wrong from the start.
That's I find looking at that scene, that memo, is so devastating because there's something very cold. The words on the page written in Washington, people are dying in Vietnam for something that has been abstracted into these percentage points by someone in the Pentagon trying to explain to his boss, why are we there? What are we doing? And when you take that down to the level of an ordinary soldier trying to do his job in this kind of impossible war, there's something, the disconnect there is just staggering, and seeing it again, it just, you know, it's hard not to get away from. People are trying to do their job. Everyone's trying to do their job.
So, Admiral Mullen, here's a question for junior or, I guess, mid-level officers. The political imperatives are go. The senior military wants to salute and say, we can do it because we can do. But if you're a junior officer or a mid-level officer and you see things are not going the way the newspapers say they are, leaving the press aside, the way your leadership tells you they should be going, what is your obligation to try to set them straight?
Well, I think part of what Ken captures in this, and I've seen about half of it, is the young ones who started to see it going south and were caught in this incredible trap of fighting and fighting for the guy on the right and the guy on the left, while at least knowing and in many cases stating that it's not going well, with an expectation that that would move up the chain and somehow be taken care of, as opposed to the need to try to turn it around themselves. I'd like, for the young ones in particular, what Barry said, rushing to Washington, I watched that in the Iraq War. I watched it in the Afghanistan War. It is our war, our generation, we're in the military, we want to go, and we're 21 or 22, and we're pretty excited about that. That's the norm. What I didn't understand, and I don't think politicians do a very good job in these very difficult circumstances, not just making courageous decisions, but that the military really does not understand that. There are very few jobs in the military where you are exposed to the politics. And what was so disheartening for me in this, in the Kennedy episode and in the first Johnson episode, is this trap therein, which is, I know I shouldn't do this, but politically I can't hack it, right, so I've got to execute. And at some point in time, and we're going to continue that until the person that knows they shouldn't do it doesn't do it and sacrifices the office they're in to make the right decision. That's true in Iraq. There's truth in that. I've watched parts that same kind of thing in Afghanistan. Presidents who are paralyzed by the politics, and despite what people might think about four-star generals and admirals, you don't know that business at all until you're at that level in the White House and you see politics at play every single day, no matter what your background is, save Barry was J5 at one point. J5, vice chairman and chairman are the three military officers that see that constantly. And they see the politics and they see what politicians are trying to do.
Ken, let's take a little step back here. I've seen 70% of what you've done, which is, in fact, I would say to our larger audience out there, if there's one bit of history you should see, it's this movie. I mean it, because it'll. But let me ask the guy who conceived it, why? What are you trying to show us?
Well, I think Lynn and I both felt that the Vietnam War was the most important event after World War II. And in fact, coincidentally, Lynn and I had spent 7 years working on a history of the Second World War, which was our first relationship with Bank of America, also looking at it from a different lens. We talked about Vietnam for a long time in a kind of abstract and intellectual way, but having kind of wrestled to the ground with the particular devices or conceits of our World War II documentary, in late 2006, I just looked at Lynn and said, we have to do Vietnam. And she said, you know, what part? I said, all of it. And we both kind of looked and gulped, knowing that we were about to go into our own big muddy and get more than waist deep in that. But I think for so many reasons, this is a seminal event in American history. A good deal of how we are today, the disunion, the hyperpartisanship, I think you can trace back to the lack of trust in government from the very things that we've been talking about this morning. The also the way in which the country was fractured, which always gives sort of oxygen to the fires of the extreme. And then those extremes, because they're louder, become more mainstream. And that feeds its own self-fulfilling kind of polarization. All of those things issue from Vietnam. But so do some really important things. Lynn has just returned from North Vietnam, where one of the people we interviewed after he made a long trip from Vietnam to our editing studios watched an early version and was so thoughtful, an NVA grunt, who then became a kind of beloved Evan Thomas in his own country. Win Knopp said wonderful things to us in the film, and you can see him throughout, but when he screened parts of the finished film recently, as Lynn did in Vietnam, he said, you know, when I was aware through the propaganda of the state that there were demonstrations going on in the United States, I took that as a sign of American weakness. I now understand that's a sign of American strength. And it may require us to sort of permit people who are farther away to offer us that understanding that despite the obvious fact that many aspects of the Vietnam War seem irredeemable in their lessons, unlike Civil War, which ends slavery and unites the country, unlike what World War II did, and not for various reasons, there may be really extraordinary things that we may be able to glean from Vietnam and be able to digest along with the classic series of mistakes and what went wrong and who was to blame and, you know, all of the things that are on the tip of our lips. I think there may be some hidden gems in there that we also felt that we could pursue that might be byproducts of just asking a question, as our Marine does for us in the opening bite: what happened? What happened? And the new scholarship that's attended to this, the ability of people from all sides to speak so eloquently, for us to try to bear witness to their testimony, to understand from declassified information and have the perspective that the passage of time has permitted, may allow us some daylight.
Let's, Ken mentioned the war at home. Let's, the next clip looks at that.
I come to this magnificent house of worship tonight because my conscience leaves me no other choice. A time comes when silence is betrayal. That time has come for us in relation to Vietnam.
11 days later, King joined Dr. Spock and perhaps half a million other protesters at a massive demonstration in Central Park, organized by a new coalition, the National Mobilization to End the War in Vietnam.
Some time ago, a crazy dream came to me. I dreamt I was walking to World War III.
That was the biggest crowd any of us had ever been in our lives. And when the front of the march got down to the United Nations, the back of the march had not yet left Central Park. That's how many people we were. Not all of the people on that march were students. And as a result, we all felt we have a chance now. You know, there's a path that we could see to ending the war.
Stop the bombing! Let us save our national honor. Stop the bombing and stop the war. Let us save American lives and Vietnamese lives. Let us take a single instantaneous step to the peace table. Stop the bombing.
The anti-war movement was growing in numbers and militancy. We are no longer interested in merely protesting the war, one organizer said. We are out to stop it.
So, General McCaffrey, you are, as that demonstration is going on, I believe you're in the field getting wounded three times. What did you think about the war back home?
Well, you know, I left to command a rifle company in combat 68-69, and a statistic that I always like to tell people, at that period in the war, 25% of the soldiers in Vietnam are draftees. 14% of the entire armed forces are draftees. In my company, 100% were draftees, except me and the first sergeant, maybe a lieutenant or two. So I was commanding a bunch of kids who were basically teenage high school graduates. They saw all this demonstration when they left. And the first sergeant and I had to explain them why we were fighting. And as Mike Mullen aptly says, I told him, look, we're here on a mission. We're trying to kill the North Vietnamese soldiers, who we admired enormously. They were clean-cut, well-armed, tactically competent. Their regimental commander with a loincloth on would spend 8 hours reconning our positions. But we had great respect for the North Vietnamese Army, for that matter, the VC. But I had to tell these soldiers, you know, we're not fighting for the country. We're fighting for each other. So that whole period is so bitter in my wife's memory and our family. And for that matter, my veterans, we have a reunion every 2 years, and these guys show up. They still call me by my call sign. I can't use my first name after 40-some-odd years. And they will talk about hiding out when they came home from Vietnam, grew their hair long, went back to college, went back to work. Overwhelmingly, they did well, I might add. You know, a couple of them are multimillionaires. A lot of them were running, you know, welding shops and farmers. So they were great kids, but that was the environment that poisoned our view. You know, I tell people to this day, my wife hates three kinds of people: the media, American politicians, and generals. And she hadn't changed her mind about any of them.
Lynn, one thing that's great about this film is we've been doing the 30,000 foot view of the leaders, but there are incredible scenarios of individual fighters, warriors on both sides. And so I'm interested from you how you chose them, what you were looking for, and what you heard in their voices, the people who actually were there fighting.
Well, yeah, there was no single criteria, frankly. We looked for as wide a range of people from different backgrounds, different times of the war, because as the general's been explaining, people's perspectives evolved a lot. So someone who got there in 65 after the Marines landed and was optimistic about the cause and the purpose and the success of the mission compared to 69 when it's mostly draftees, people's different soldiers had such different experiences, so we tried to represent all of that. What we really were looking for, both in the U.S. and in Vietnam, were people who were able to and willing to share their deepest feelings about this extraordinarily painful and difficult experience. And, you know, that's asking a lot. So we talked to probably 1,000 people to choose the 100 that we interviewed, and 80 or so are in the film. And we've just been bowled over, just really blown away by the sort of honesty and openness and courage, really, of every single person in our film talking about these extremely difficult moments. And one of the things that comes across quite a lot, both among American and Vietnamese veterans, is, you know, sort of inner conflicts about the morality of the activity of war, what's involved, and how you survive it, how you go on living your life afterwards, how you do or don't find a way to talk to your closest, you know, people in your life about what you've been through. And at this point in their lives, so many people are just, you know, willing to let us in on this, not really secret, but kind of closed off part of experience that if you haven't been in combat, as Ken was saying, you can't know it.
It's very, very powerful. Admiral Mullen, I mean, one thing you hear in here is that there is a contradiction for these young warriors. On the one hand, they are supposed to be moral people. They are supposed to think about the morality of what they're doing. But on the other hand, they're supposed to just kind of close that off to do their job, and because they can be paralyzed by it if they think about it too much. If you're a junior officer, how do you try to deal with that tension when you're training young men and women to handle that kind of dual obligation to be, both be moral but also to be a killer?
Well, I mean, I think Barry, having, you know, been in the infantry, would better answer this. My take on that is that the young officers are really raw and really young, and they're trying to figure out how to both be in charge and make sure that their men in this case know what needs to be done and take care of them. So my sense is, I mean, when you're in the environment, you're not thinking a lot about that. One, two, and I can translate that to Iraq and to Afghanistan. One of the things for me, and I'll wear the scars of this war my whole life, but when the war first broke out, I thought two things. I'm living in a nice set of quarters in Washington. I'm a Navy three-star. And there were two in Iraq. Sorry, we went into Iraq. I said, I wonder if the American people are going to support our men and women in uniform. And it took me a year plus to say yes. And I wonder how many of this generation of veterans will be homeless, similar to my generation, and will we be any better? And I'm not sure as a country that we are. The hazard, the moral hazard that Lynn talks about is what I've seen in Iraq. I've seen it in Afghanistan. It is, and I thought the film did a great job in one part capturing this, that was almost knowing it was wrong. You just sort of seal that off, and you're trying to kill as many people as you can kill, and you're trying to survive, and you're fighting for the ones on the right and the left, and then everybody has to deal with that when they get back, then and now in every war. We don't do a very good job up front talking to our young ones about what they're about to get into.
Ken, is this a timeless thing in your other wars, in the Civil War and in Vietnam and World War II? Were these issues the same, or did something change in the 60s? Was it different in some ways?
I think it's really different because you're talking about that moment, say at the platoon level or the company level, where you're in some action and you're being pulled in a lot of ways. And one of our Marines up in 67 in I Corps, right up near the DMZ, is sent out on the classic patrol. A couple of NVA show themselves and spray with AK-47. The lieutenant or the captain says, "I want their bodies." And all of the enlisted guys are saying, "Sir, this is as old as Custer. Please don't go." But for them, the officers, it's body count. So you've got this overlay of kind of systems analysis that has trickled down from Robert McNamara, and that's influencing what is clearly an obvious thing. And so they go, he's severely wounded. It plows into lots of things. But there is a sense of the soldiers who have the experience being caught in a way that I never heard them. If this was a Civil War soldier, he's willing to give his life for his government, he says, for the cause, he says, for the president, he says, for the larger sense of the United States of America, for his God, for his family, for his wife, for his children. These are all uncomplicated, direct things, and he's willing to write it down and walk into Bull Run the next week and get killed. There's not that sort of thing. There is exactly as Admiral Mullen has described and General McCafferty has described, this sort of intense and unbelievable bond that exists within the soldiers in combat about saving the guy to the left and to the right. And that is a huge part of our film and is a constant in what we've done. But there's some other now mediating force, which is the miscalculation that is trickling down. I mean, this is not just a military phenomenon. We've covered young cub reporters like David Halberstam and Malcolm Brown and Neil Sheehan, and Neil is coming there desperate to get there because he doesn't want to miss the plum assignment of his life and wants to see the triumph of democracy over communism, wants to be able to report about it, and all of a sudden there's a huge disconnect because what's being issued out of MACV in Saigon or out of the Pentagon in terms of after-action reports is super different from what he's either seen or what the guys on the ground, the officers on the ground, are telling him. And so I think that that's getting to be a little different here.
You think also, we were just the other day at the Army General Command and Staff College in Leavenworth with one of our advisors and interviewees, Colonel James Wilbanks, and he was asked about this sort of same kind of question. He said he thought that one of the things that didn't happen in Vietnam that we need to learn from is sort of the limits of power. You know, that you have the artillery, you have the firepower, you have the napalm, you have all these tools of war, But if you are going to exert them, you might be killing civilians, or you definitely will be killing civilians, and then you end up making more enemies, leaving aside the moral question of what that means for our country in terms of trying to help the people of Vietnam. But a lot of civilians, as the general is saying, are bearing the brunt. And that's got to be, you know, that's an overlay that happened in World War II, but the American public wasn't really as aware or concerned about firebombing of Tokyo and the, you know, we had been attacked, and so we sort of had the moral high ground there. But here we didn't so much after a while. And the part of what motivated Martin Luther King to come out against the war was photographs of children who had been hurt by napalm. So that's a, you know, that reality for the Vietnam War sort of changes the conversation.
And one other thing I'll add, the same Marine is also talking about, he says, war is a real estate business. But it wasn't in Vietnam. And so he said, you don't like to be wounded again in the same place that you've already taken. And so you find this sort of sense that we're going to pursue the enemy, it's where the enemy is, but we're not going to collect real estate. And because you're not collecting real estate, you have these, you know, Sisyphean tasks, at least from the guys at the bottom, climbing up a hill at great cost, taking it, overcoming the enemy 99% of the time, winning, enemy dissolving before there's actually a chance for surrender or the sort of the ultimate prize. But then you cede that territory and find out a month later or a few weeks later or a year later that might be another place to pursue the enemy. And so he says you don't like to be wounded in the same place twice.
By the way, a comment on Jim Wilbanks. He wrote one of the best operational books on the war, Lamson 719. Mm. It should be required reading for our general officers. It was a disaster. It wrecked the Vietnamese elite armed forces. We lost 800 U.S. Army and Marine helicopters, and it shouldn't have happened.
And Wilbanks also says, you know your enemy.
Right. Yeah,
that's
exactly
what we didn't know. We didn't bother. We had a kind of hubris or arrogance that we inherited from our two recent conventional warfare triumphs, or at least stalemates, and that just did not apply to our curiosity about the Vietnamese.
We still have that.
Add to arrogance, there was some cynicism. Let's play our next clip.
Opposition to the Saigon government is not just Viet Cong.
How many governments actually care for the Vietnamese people?
The student anti-war, anti-American movement is larger than its small demonstrations indicate.
You don't need military aid to promote democracy in Vietnam, to return to the Vietnamese people their right, their right to speak freely. You don't need even one penny. You don't need to consult the White House. You don't need to care about the American media. You don't need France, you don't need Chinese, you don't need Americans. If you really care for Vietnam, then you turn back inside.
South Vietnamese President Nguyen Van Thieu was campaigning for re-election. The Americans had insisted on it and urged him not to rig the race for fear it would resemble too closely the fraudulent communist elections routinely denounced by the United States. But Thieu made sure no serious candidates ran against him and claimed to have won 94% of the vote. It became known as the one-man election and added to the ranks of what was called the Third Force, South Vietnamese hoping for a negotiated settlement and an end to the bloodshed. By the middle of 1971, Nixon and Kissinger were looking for a way to get all U.S. troops out of Vietnam before his re-election campaign began the following year. But to do so without causing Saigon to fall too soon.
The only something is to prevent the collapse in 72. If it's got to go to the communists, it'd be better to have it happen in the first 6 months of the new term than have it go on and on and on. I'm being very cold-blooded about it.
I know exactly what we're up to.
But on the other hand, if Cambodia allows and Vietnam go down the drain in September 72, then they'll say, you went into the East, you lost so many lives just to wind up where you could have been in the first year.
That's a pretty rough scene there at the end. We've got about 4 minutes left. General, react to that, if you would.
You know, I had two sessions with McNamara well after the war, while I was in the White House working with the Clinton administration. He brought out that book, we remember, Seeking Expatiation from the liberal elites who he thought he had failed. And all of us who'd served in that war, I say all of us, I think overwhelmingly the reaction was, how dare they come back and explain they thought the war was unwinnable and continue to send 4 or 5 more years of 19-year-old draftees to their death or getting maimed. One comment deserves to be made. One of the last slides I use in almost every address talking about national security challenges, the last slide is the annual Gallup poll about what degree of trust you have in the following American institutions. And I call it a bad news slide for democracy. And it's, I think Ken made the point earlier, Vietnam changed everything. So suddenly you're looking at a slide where the president's normally in a 30 percentile range, Congress in the single digits, the court system, organized religion are widely distrusted by the American people. The most trusted institution in our society, bar none, is the U.S. Armed Forces. Mike Mullen and the people that ran, were senior officers running the war in Iraq and Afghanistan, should feel pretty proud about that. Because basically what the American people say is, look, we send our boys and girls off to serve in the Navy, Air Force, Marines, Army, Coast Guard, and they write us and tell us this is an institution of honor and courage and commitment. But I think this Vietnam War was a turning point. You listen to that kind of a transcript from Nixon and Henry Kissinger, who I have great admiration for also, but that is the cold-blooded insight into political realpolitik.
And you're going to have, you could have accepted the terms whatever you met in late January of 69 and gotten as good, if not better, terms then, and you'd have a lot, many thousands of more Americans alive and hundreds of thousands of Vietnamese still alive. And that, it seems to me that one of the great things that we're able to see when we study the war are all those factions, wherever they may appear, where that abstraction takes place. And when the right. abstraction takes place, if you think you can quantify it into 70, 20, 10, you're in big trouble. If you think you can make a kind of political calculus, and all of them, Truman, everybody, all the way through, is making decisions that are plowing us deeper and deeper into Vietnam based on domestic political considerations, and that means, will I get elected, not what's best for the United States of America.
I mean, I hesitate to defend Richard Nixon here, but I will. That tape implies that he was entirely cynical.
Right.
I've listened to a lot of those tapes. He is cynical on some of them, but on other ones, he really wants to win.
Yes.
He really does. Yeah, and that idea that we could just go back to 1969, I think that's naive too. 1969, the North Vietnamese were not going to permit the Chu government to exist,
right.
period. Nixon wanted to get to the point where they would. Now, maybe he's a little cynical because he thinks they're going to fall, but he fought for 4 years to get the North Vietnamese to agree to allow the Chu government to exist. He did get there.
But my point, I raise this because I think we've done justice to the superb, supremely smart politician and policymaker that he was, and big difference there. I mean, sometimes you can hear the cynicism of the politics, but I think you can see in the film sometimes the brilliance of the policymaker.
Well, there's also the sense, you know, once Nixon and Kissinger felt that we have to address the Cold War, you know, nuclear detente with Russia, open the door to China. the antagonistic relationship with Vietnam is really not central to our foreign policy anymore. And so what's the significance of what's happening in Vietnam compared to this much bigger game they're playing as they describe it? So they're just, you know, and that's good for the world in a way. I mean, we can't just take Vietnam in isolation. That's what our film is about, and that's what our country was focused on. But they are looking at a much grander tableau and trying to, you know, pull the levers of power in a very sophisticated and worthwhile way.
So, and sometimes brave with regard to mining Haiphong Harbor on the eve of the signing of the first SALT agreement.
We could go on about this all day. It's a fascinating subject. I hope all of you see this film. It's noon now, so I think we're supposed to end. But thank you to our panel, and thank you for coming.